Welcome back. Market's still in the red, but we were speaking about interest rates with Shobha developers. Now, after the Reserve Bank's last monetary policy, one has seen a bunch of banks linking their interest rates to the repo rate. Not too many. SBI had already done that for some of their working capital loans. But last week, Bank of Baroda did that. They have linked their retail loans to the repo rate. And they've also announced a new variant of home loan product, which is also linked to the repo rate. P.S. Jayakumar, Managing Director, CEO of Bank of Baroda, joins us. Good morning, Mr. Jayakumar. Can you tell us what percentage of your loans are retail and whether this linkage to repo on the part of your retail lending rates can be a pressure on your margins?
I think there are two parts to it. One, our retail portfolio is around 23-24% of our total book. But the intention is to try to move to repo rate for a broader range of product as a partly as a method of linking it to their monetary transmission. So I think we would probably focus on that in due course, I mean, the course of this month. Now, at this stage, it's early to comment upon margins. We expect deposit rates also to come down. In fact, we had already reduced our deposit rates by about 25 basis points on the 1 to 2 year tenor. And I'm hoping even if there was some marginal reduction in the margins, there is going to be a slightly better treasury earnings this quarter on account of the yields on the bonds. So we should stay close to whatever our guidance are.
Okay. Mr. Jayakumar, good morning. So you said that deposit rates, you've already brought it down by 25 basis points. Over the next, say, 6 to 12 months, how much do you think deposit rates could come down further? I mean, how much of the transmission is left, not just for you, but for the industry as a whole?
I think there'll probably be some more room for reduction in the deposit rate, though I really can't quantify what that will be. I think we'll get a clarity as we go through this week and the next week, because it's not about one bank reducing the rate. We also need to see the industry in its in overall sense reducing the deposit rates. I think that's where we're heading towards. So one should expect a lower interest rate moving forward.
Okay. You know, what percentage of your loans, your liabilities are current and savings account?
Well, our CASA ratio consequent to the merger declined from 40% to 37%. And that was because one of the three banks had a lower CASA ratio.
Okay.
So there's been some downward revision, but then we're back to putting the right kind of focus through cash management and other programs to try to rev up the current account and savings account rate back to the 41-42% level.
No, I'm just trying to link you. When you cut the rates, you cut the interest rates by 20 or 25, was it, for your fixed 1 and 3 year tenors, right?
Yeah.
So it must have fallen for about 50% of your liability?
Well, it would have fallen for 50% of the time deposit liability, yes.
Okay. All right.
And that would be then, if you were to take a 60-40, then you're looking at it probably reducing it by what? For the 30% of the deposit base, roughly, plus or minus. But it's a little bit more also because there were bulk deposit in one of the erstwhile banks, and those are being either returned or repriced to a lower level. So I think for us, the margin compression would probably be not there because of the differential cost of funds between the three banks and us when the interest rates starting to align with the Bank of Baroda interest rates.
Okay. That's what I was driving at. What will be the margin impact? Sorry.
Okay. No, so by the end of the fiscal, you reckon that the margins could be, I mean, in this quarter, it declined to about 2.6%. Will it be in this range itself?
I would think, yes, it should be probably a little bit higher. It is going to also depend upon how the slippages work and how the net recoveries work, because that's had a significant impact on the way the margins move. So I think so long as we can contain the slippages and improve the recovery, I mean, the net position doesn't change materially from where we are, I would think the margins on the balance should increase. So we have to work through that collection numbers.
We are about 45 days, about half the current quarter is over. are you a little confident about slippages, or is the confidence slipping because of the problems in the NBFC space? May you have to report higher gross slippages?
So I think as far as the large accounts are concerned, barring one or two accounts, I don't think there is any real surprise over there.
Okay.
But to a question whether some of these NBFC accounts would be classified as non-performing assets and would that affect the slippage ratio, my sense is that issue probably is going to be avoided for a significant part, although you know some slippages will happen because the resolutions may not be in place.
Okay.
But as far as the two large accounts are concerned, let's talk about DHFL and others. There's a very determined effort on the parts of both the bank and the support of the company to find a resolution in a very early manner.
Okay. What about particularly for the SME and agri portfolio? I mean, are you seeing higher amount of stress there? Do you expect higher slippages as we head into the next few quarters?
I think we have to wait and see. For us, in the last quarter, the agri portfolio did show certain slippages.
Mm.
But on the other hand, we have also improved the level of collection intensity on these programs and hoping that would come to keep the slippages within the normal bound range.
Mm.
On SME, we have been consistently moving up on the quality of the credit. And also a lot of our programs are based on supply chain or based on, you know, vehicle financing, equipment financing, etc., which are asset-backed funding. We are not seeing any significant deterioration to any change to conclude that the MSME portfolio is going to deteriorate in this quarter. Slippages are going to be higher in this quarter.
Okay.
So in other words, we are saying there's a fair amount. We're seeing, continue to see some stability because of the mix of the portfolio that we have and the various other things we have done to go up on the quality of the portfolio.
Mr. Jayakumar, just a word more on this DHFL kind of situation. You think your banks can go forward without SEBI agreeing to allowing mutual funds to join the creditor agreements?
Actually, I think there are two parts to it. One is to first get the arrangements closed out so that we are clear what the resolution plan is. So that's one part of the work. And the other part of the work, obviously, is to get the consensus among lenders, including the mutual fund. Now, all I would like to say at this point of time is that there is a fair amount of confidence we'll find out a solution, because it's in the interest of everybody to get a solution over here.
Yeah, we are hoping for that. Okay, I wanted to ask you about this new home loan product you have launched. If you can describe that to us, and you know what kind of loan growth you are expecting because of that. And separately, there are others who are telling us that every time one of these home loans or this link to repo rate happens, banks also increase the spread between the MCLR and the home loan rate.
Yeah.
What is it? What's the situation in your bank?
Well, yes. So I think there are two things we're trying to achieve over here. One is to directly link it to the policy rate.
Mm-hmm.
And once the spread over the policy rate is set, then I don't think it can be maneuvered each time the policy rate changes so that we get the same yield.
Mm-hmm.
In our case, at the point we have set the rate now, it is cheaper than the MCLR rate.
Mm-hmm.
So and we cannot, the margins would be fair, is fixed at 295 basis points over our repo rate, and those numbers won't change.
Mm-hmm.
So as the repo rate comes down or moves up, the mortgage loan pricing would move in tandem.
Mm.
So I think the concern that we might move the spread and thereby keep the pricing at the same level would not quite happen because the way the program is run.
Is there a new commitment you are giving?
In this case, no monetary transmission can happen.
Mm. No. Is that a commitment you are giving? I believe this is rampant industry practice.
No, I think the repo rate mechanism has not actually been implemented other than with the State Bank of India. And some bank, at least one bank, has linked it to the government T-bill rate.
Mm.
But I doubt whether this is going to happen. And as far as we are concerned, as far as Bank of Baroda is concerned, now that the spreads over the repo rate has been set, those spreads won't be tampered with in a manner it would be disadvantageous to the customer.
Okay. Mr. Jayakumar, you know, the finance minister Nirmala Sitharaman was to meet the CEOs, or did meet the CEOs of various PSU banks last week. What exactly transpired there? I mean, what are the key initiatives that the government could take now to solve some of the stresses in the sector?
I think we had a very fair hearing of the set of issues that are facing the banking system, whether it is the growth or whether it is our own technology or whether it is the people-related challenges. The sense I got after coming out of the meeting is the finance minister heard us all well. She took notes of the key points of the material points of the discussion, and you know, we would, I'm sure, see some actions that would again push up or propel growth. But more than that, I also think the interest rates cycle and the way it's turning around should also give some momentum to growth. And also, as we head towards the festival season, I remember we are at this point of time with the lean season, we should start seeing growth come back again, particularly in some of the sectors like auto, motorcycle, durables, and so on.
So,
as far as retail loans are concerned, our trajectory continues to remain the same in the 21-22% kind of growth rate. But then individual banks' position might be different from the industry as a whole. But I do think consequent to the reduction, I mean, rather the tax benefits that have been given in the budget, and from whatever market feedback we are getting, the affordable loan housing segment is continuing to show some strong improvement. The problem seems to be with the more expensive apartments.
Yeah.
So I think we can expect the affordable housing segment to continue to drive the mortgage growth.
Okay. Well, just a final question. What are the loan growth numbers and credit cost provisioning numbers you are working with for the year?
I'm staying to the same kind of a direction we shared last time. There's no point changing these. We're looking at when we started, we were looking at the growth rate to be in the 15% level. And we were looking at a deposit rate growth of about 10%. And we were looking for a return on equity in the single digit number. And we also had anticipated that, or rather, we feel that if there is any kind of a deterioration or kind of slippages or provisioning, there are also certain non-core assets which are up for sale. So between all of this, we think there is a very high probability we'll stay to the guidance we have given so far.
Okay, okay. Mr. Jayakumar, pleasure speaking with you. Thank you very much indeed for joining us. So that's one of the banks that has linked its home loan rates to the repo rate. So an external benchmarking, which is ensures transmission.
Okay, fair enough. Let's see now how the market is still almost at the low point of the day. The Nifty is down 55 points.